Hey David, this is David Kwon. I'm 10 years older than you. Oh man, this is a tough one. But yeah, you are still a very extremely devoted born again Christian. By this point, you really embrace the concept of being a sort of a Jesus freak, and so much of your life. I would think it's safe to assume that Christianity is the most important thing in your life, and you feel that it will be forever, literally forever, even after you die. That's what you believe in. And it's really weird to kind of talk to the self that I was, which is you, knowing that this is how you turn out to be. You are a super devoted Christian. And you do so many of your activities in life are related to your faith, and church retreats, daily devotionals, the friends you have, the things you go to, all those things is so interconnected in your with your faith. I really understand that. And then there's me now, 10 years later. This is actually 3 years from where you are. By the time you're 17 and a half, it's kind of when you make a break. But it's a pretty tough process. I think I like I consider I call a lot of people call it the deconversion process, but it's not really accurate for me, because I wasn't deconverted from it. I was never converted to it, or it never felt like a because technically I was converted into Christianity, but Dad was a pastor even before I was born. Christianity was kind of a given thing. Even before being born, my dad named my Korean name is based off of a Bible verse. Uttam, it's based off of Mark chapter 10, verse 44. I'm probably gonna do a video on my Korean name, so that's the topic for a different video. But yeah, this is the type of person that you are. Man, this is a. I don't know what to say to you. I don't know whether I should say, give you suggestions on how do you keep your Christian faith, or to tell you about how it happens, how you end up deconverted, how you end up to be me. In a lot of ways, I think it's inevitable. Knowing the type of person that I am, that you are, the personality that we share. Ultimately, it is not compatible with Christianity. It is not. So this is my suggestion in order to keep your faith. If this suggestion, if you ever can follow this suggestion, which I don't think you can, my suggestion is to do less with church. Much less. Stop questioning things. Don't read the Bible too much. Don't read too much, actually. Just kind of take everything. Start. Don't be so skeptical. Don't be so cynical. Don't be so questioning. Don't participate in so many different things about your faith. You get so over involved, and this faith becomes rules your life so much. It's all you think about. It's all you question. That. Ultimately, that's what leads you to atheism. Believe it or not, reading the Bible leads you to atheism. I know that's the most probably the most ironic thing that is coming to you right now. It's incomprehensible, the fact that your holy scripture is what leads you to atheism, but it is. That's what leads you to it. Don't think too much about the afterlife. I know that's Christianity is focused around that, but that's what leads you to atheism. That's primarily the thing. The concept of heaven and hell, that concept, you're thinking about it, that's what leads you to atheism. So don't think about it too much. In fact, my suggestion is don't think too much. Don't read too much. Don't think too much. Don't participate in your faith too much. Just go with the flow. That is my suggestion if you want to keep your faith. But you have a personality where that's going to be impossible. You have a very questioning personality. You want your faith to be as logical as possible. You want to be able to prove to those evolutionists and atheists that God can be proven logically, that God can be proven with the evidence in the natural world, that Christianity is a force of good in the world. You believe all these things, and you believe that the Bible has all the answers. And so, in order to really prove those answers, you go out there and you evangelize on the internet, you discuss. But ultimately, and ironically, that is what leads you to me doing that. So if you want to keep it, stop doing that or do less of it. Think less, which is my message for you to keep your faith. I don't think you can do it. That's the thing. Also, the main reason you end up becoming me is your sense of compassion. So again, the afterlife question. The biggest reason you want to become a pastor, the biggest reason you want to devote your life to becoming a missionary and then a pastor, is because you think that's the most important thing in life to do. Why? Because you don't want anyone to suffer in hell. You don't want anyone. So you want to get this message out to as many people as possible, because it's the most important thing. What is more important? A 100 years of living this life, or an eternity in hell? The possibility of eternity in hell. What is more important? A horrible life, 100 years, or a horrible life for eternity afterwards? So because you're so consumed by this idea of not wanting anyone you love to end up in hell, that's why you take that's why you have this goal of wanting to become a pastor, wanting to become a missionary. But it's that same kind of compassion motive that drives you to become me. So I guess be less compassionate? I don't know. Like I said, I think the things that you read, the things that you feel about what you read, the things that, ultimately, I think in this aspect of your view here, it's inevitable that you are going to turn out an atheist and kind of value the moral systems that are not religion-based. You're not going to support utilitarianism. You're going to consider it a great amount of thought, but it's going to be a really, really tough process for you. This is one of those turning points in your life. You have a couple in your life. The first turning point, of course, becoming immigration to America. That's your very first turning point. That changes the essence of who you are, actually. And then your deconversion from Christianity, or your divorce from Christianity, is probably the most important turning point in your life. And it's a turning point that you're going to struggle with for years. Because you're going to be a closeted atheist. You're not going to tell your parents about it for 2 years, I think. About 2 years. And you fake being a Christian for 2 years. Believe it or not. But it's one of the hardest things you've ever done in your life. And it's later in life, when you're 23, 24, 25, the question of religion, the question of God, question of faith, question of morality, is still something that you question every single day, and it's still such a big question. But it's tough, but I really can't think of any way where, I can't think of a scenario in which, if you have the same personality as me, if you have the same thought processes as me, I can't see how you can't be an atheist. I just don't see that as a possibility. This is where I think, I do have a certain view of determinism. I do believe in a great deal of it. And I think this is one of those instances where there's no way, this is inevitable. Which is unfortunate for you, but I think you'll find out after all that you go through, in the end, it ends up being the most liberating experience of your life. Being freed from Christianity. Being freed from the culture of it. The embracing of death. that this culture forces on you. And you know, it brings you almost to suicidal ideations, but you're able to overcome it. I can definitely, you know, but it's a tough thing. This is why me coming to break off from Christianity is when I read The God Delusion, which in your time is not even published yet, but it's by this scientist, Richard Dawkins. In the very last chapter of his book, God Delusion, he talks about, you know, Christianity as a form of child abuse, or you know, religious instruction as a form of child abuse. And in most cases, maybe that's not the case, but in my case, in your case, it actually is, because of this intense struggle you have in order to break away from the religion, in order to maintain your friendly, familiar relationship with your dad and your mom, while still being true to your values and your ideology. It's tough. It nearly breaks you. You are almost completely overwhelmed by that deconversion process. I don't know, that's not inevitable in my opinion. If there was another version of me who did not, you know, overcome that, I think that's understandable. What I don't think doesn't make sense is a version of me that ends up still being Christian at the age of 26. I don't see that as a possibility. But yeah, that those are my thoughts on that. I know, you know, if a 15-year-old version of me was watching this video, I would assume it's very discouraging to him to watch this. It's a devastating thing to know that the thing that you believe in so dearly in the future may be something you no longer believe in anymore, because it's such an important thing. And I know the first question that's going to pop up in my 15-year-old self is, am I going to end up in hell? And that's the kind of questioning that leads you to become me, honestly. So if that's the first question that pops on your mind, I say give it time. Give it some thoughts. And this is how it happens. So that's my video. Oh, I guess I want to make one more point here is, I talked to, you know, my 10-year-old version of myself, 13-year-old version of myself, 14-year-old version of myself, and when I look at those guys, you know, I'm left inspired. And I think part of the reason is because I felt so certain about this, at least this one thing in my life. I think after I shattered my faith is kind of when, you know, it's such a painful process that I think it kind of did break me in certain ways. I wouldn't say that it's the lack of Christianity in my life that breaks me, but it's the process of breaking from such an ingrained ideology. It was like breaking from part of my identity. You know, it's forcing myself, just divorcing myself from this part of identity I've had for over 17 years since birth. It's crazy. The moment where I've came to conclude, you know, I've had to repeat this to myself multiple times simply because I could not believe it. And this is a sentence I repeated. I am an atheist. I'm an atheist. I'm an atheist. I could not believe it. I could not believe it because I've been so ingrained as being a Christian. This concept of me being not Christian anymore was a monumental one, and it was a knock in the face, knock in the guts, nearly totally broke me. And you know, just coming, I think it took me, you know, at least 4 years to really finalize the entire deconversion process. It took me 4 years for that. And it's now 8 years since then. So obviously I've come a long way into accepting my deconversion and things of that nature, but it's a process. And I hate to tell you, you know, you 15-year-old version of me, it's not going to be easy. But you don't think Christianity is easy either. Truth is not easy. I think if I was born an atheist, I don't know, if I was born a weak, like not such a caring Christian, it wouldn't matter as much. But I think it's because it was so deeply ingrained in my life. It's not necessarily atheism itself or, you know, not having Christianity that made my life so hard. It's the fact that Christianity was such a hard thing to break away from. I think that was the problem. But yeah, that's my video on this. Yeah, that's really all I have to say. So, cheers.